Hello, listeners. This is Thaddeus. Before getting into this Splitting Arrows episode, I wanted to give a bit of a warning. The film we're about to review, 1976's Robin and Marian, includes discussion, depiction, and arguably glorification of suicide. If this is a sensitive topic for you, please be aware before choosing to watch the film yourself. And if you'd like to skip over our discussion about this element of the movie, it primarily occurs roughly between the 39 and 46 minute marks. If you or someone you know is experiencing suicidal thoughts, please remember that help is available. The National Suicide Prevention Hotline in the UK is 0800-689-5652. Again, in the UK, that's 0800-689-5652. The United States has the three-digit suicide and crisis lifeline number of 988. Again, that's 988 in the US. And Lifeline Australia is 131114. That's Lifeline Australia, 131114. Wherever in the world you are, if you need help, please reach out. Now, for as serious as that all sounds, this episode was a lot of fun to record. More than any other Robin Hood movie, this is a genuinely thought-provoking film, and I thoroughly enjoyed the discussion with our special guests. I hope that you enjoy it too. Thank you for listening. Another Splitting Arrows episode of Into the Greenwood. This is sort of the perfect follow-up to our last Splitting Arrows episode, which was about the Legend of Robin Hood miniseries from 1975. This is coming out only a year later in 1976. And a major part of our discussion in our assessment of the Legend of Robin Hood was how much it really represented that change. We did see before with Wolf's Head, but more fully realized with Legend of Robin Hood, that change from Robin Hood as the storybook swashbuckler to the gritty outlaw. And this movie, coming out just a year later, Robin and Marian, also is going to be picking up that sort of thread. We're seeing the Robin Hood that is not Errol Flynn by any stretch of the imagination. We're seeing a Robin Hood that gets down and dirty, that gets old and weary and tired. This is going to be our first older Robin Hood since Russell Hicks's small role in a very much more traditionally swashbuckly film. So it's going to be really interesting to see what we think of Robin and Marian from 1976, starring Sean Connery and Audrey Hepburn. And this is also going to be notable in that this is going to be the first Robin Hood movie we've had, really since Errol Flynn, that had star power behind it. This has got big names, a lot of big names, and we'll get to those in a minute, in a way that we have not seen for almost 40 years at this point. We've covered a lot of Robin Hood movies, but to be honest, a lot of them are like our assessments of different B-grade kind of films. This has got real stars and really substantive talent. Joining me to discuss this film, we've got Richard Hopkins-Lutz again, who's popped off. He'll be right back in just a moment. Joining us again is Emily Rich. It's been a little while since we've had you on the podcast. Glad that you could join us again here, Emily. And joining us for the first time for a Splitting Arrows episode, but not his first time on the podcast, we have Will Hoff from all the way in Melbourne, which means that we've got three different continents being represented for this recording. A nice international gathering for our look at Robin and Marian. How's everybody doing tonight? It's tonight for me. It's afternoon for Emily and Rick and early morning for Will.
What a way to start the day.
Yeah.
Doing okay.
So, Emily, I know you have seen this movie. And this is, I'm very excited that you're joining us because this is the only theatrical Robin Hood film that has Marian's name in the title. And you're kind of our Marian guru.
I do think it's really exciting that she gets to be a title character here. I have seen it once before, and I've been meaning to rewatch it for probably the last 2 years. So I'm really excited to see it for the second time.
So how long has it been since you've seen it?
I think I probably saw it in 2016 or 2015 for the first time.
For half a second, I thought you were going to say, I saw it in theaters, but no. Given how we were just discussing that you were too young to get the Duran Duran reference that Rick made earlier.
Wow. Okay.
I am lucky enough that the first time I saw 1938, The Adventures of Robin Hood, that was in theaters, but that was pretty fun to see it.
Because you're a time traveler.
Absolutely.
That is really cool. That is the 38 Adventures of Robin Hood. I would love to see in a theater on a big screen. I've never have done that. That would be a really phenomenal thing.
I have wanted to repeat the experience ever since. I agree.
Yeah. All right. And Will, I'm sure you also have seen this movie, Robin and Marian. In fact, it is available to watch on YouTube. Thanks to you. How long has it been since you've seen the movie, Will?
Probably a couple of years. I watch it quite often, or at least I start it quite often. It's one of those movies I get cravings for quite a lot to pop on. So I have got a lot of strong memories of the first half, and then the second half is a little more hazy. But I try and watch it every couple of years because I do find it really enjoyable and really sort of oddly comforting in a melancholy sort of way. So in a lot of ways, it's a comfort movie just as much as the Errol Flynn film is, which is, depending on who you ask, maybe a bit rough. But yeah, there's just something about it that's quite comforting that I enjoy. So I watch it every now and then. But it's funny the thing you said about Star Power, because that's the thing that sort of got me when I first watched it. Because I was like, well, I like Sean Connery. I like Audrey Hepburn. I like Robert Shaw. I like Nicole Williams. John Barry's done the score, so we are, what a treat this film is before it even starts.
Right, right. So, Rick, have you seen this movie?
Very, very long time ago, like 90s. So, let's effectively treat it as I don't remember.
Okay, good. It's always kind of fun if somebody's going in at least a little bit fresh.
I remember I watched it when I was a teenager. Because my dad liked this movie, but honestly, other than Sean Connery and Audrey Hepburn being in it, I couldn't tell you much about it. Other than that, it goes for that visual realism sort of a thing.
Mm-hmm. So let's cover a little bit of the star power that this movie has, because not only does it have some big names, like popular names, it also has like really notable talent. It has actors who are winning awards, actors who were extremely lauded during their time. It was directed by Richard Lester, who's got kind of a mixed bag of results, shall we say. Kind of made a name for himself with the Beatles movies, Hard Day's Night and Help. Been credited with kind of helping launch what would become music videos based on the editing of those films. He was once called the father of MTV, and his rejoinder to that was, well, then I want a blood test. He's also known for producing the Christopher Reeve Superman movies and then stepping in to finish the directing of Superman 2 after Richard Donner was fired, and directing Superman 3. From what I read, he kind of wasn't familiar with Superman before kind of being handed the reins of these projects, and that might explain some of the choices that were made in those movies. Yeah. He also did, though, direct the Three Musketeers and Four Musketeers films from the 70s that starred Richard York, and so they're is that kind of like solid action adventure historical thing that we see are going to see here with Robin and Marian. So like I said, a kind of mixed bag of film work, as well as several other projects he worked on, of course, too. Our writer is James Goldman, who is the older brother of William Goldman. And
I did wonder about that.
William Goldman, writer of many fantastic works, probably most known these days for Princess Bride.
But also Butch Cassidy and the Sundance Kid.
That's one of his big Hollywood credits. James Goldman, the writer of this movie, his kind of most notable, well-known film writing credit is The Lion in Winter, which is, of course, the amazing film that came out in the late 60s with Peter O'Toole and Catherine Hepburn as Henry II and Eleanor of Aquitaine. It also has King Richard, or the prince who will become King Richard and the prince who will become King John. And we get to see different takes on Richard and John in this movie. So that's fun. Just one random other little thing, a much smaller, lesser known project that James Goldman wrote was a 1986 TV movie called Anastasia, The Mystery of Anna, which I only bring up at all because it was Olivia de Havilland's last film appearance.
Hmm. I've never heard of that movie.
Yeah, I did some digging for it during when it was Olivia de Havilland's 100th birthday, and I was doing a kind of deep dive on her films. So our Robin Hood is Sean Connery. I don't need to go into his filmography. It's extensive. He's one of the defining movie stars of the late 20th century. Our Marian is Audrey Hepburn. Again, immensely famous. Oscar winner. Sean Connery won Oscars too, or at least one Oscar. You know, Audrey Hepburn, not perhaps quite as well remembered, except for a few films. She wasn't as prolific as an actor as somebody like Connery was, because she didn't always work as an actress. She kind of selectively took jobs. This movie is actually the first movie she had made in 8 years. She was semi-retired at the time. And then she went on to go be a special ambassador for UNICEF in the 80s and early 90s. So incredible human being, incredible story, got stranded in the Netherlands during the Nazi occupation, helped the resistance, served as a nurse, and then became a huge movie star, fashion icon, and then huge career as a humanitarian. She was, according to one account I read, persuaded to take this role as Marian to come out of retirement because her sons were really excited about the idea of her being in a movie with James Bond. Another art thing I read said that she was persuaded because there was so much talent associated with the film. And we do have a lot of other talent. We have as our Sheriff of Nottingham, we have Robert Shaw. This is the year after he played Captain Quint in Jaws. He was extremely well known in his time. well-known for a few roles, at least these days, was also a reasonably prolific writer, and he took his writing very seriously, much more seriously than he took his acting. And Will, you alluded earlier to this being the rematch with him and Connery. So do you want to explain that reference?
Yeah, very exciting rematch. So Robert Shaw played Red Grant, the Spectre agent in From Russia with Love in 1963 against Sean Connery, of course. So this is their chance to have it out again many, many years later.
Yes.
I forgot that he played that. And that is actually one of my favorite Bond movies. So
yeah, that might be my favorite Connery Bond movie, at least.
It's a good one. It's solid. Don't get me wrong, it loves me some Goldfinger, but From Russia with Love is just a solid spy movie.
I read multiple accounts that Robert Shaw kind of considered Sean Connery as his sort of acting adversary. Like, it was Sean Connery's star that was like preventing him from rising a little bit higher as a star. And like, Sean Connery was getting the roles that he might have gotten if Sean Connery weren't there. So now he gets to, I don't know, physically duke it out with him. Our Little John is played by Nicole Williamson, who is not as famous as those other names, but that's kind of because he didn't seek the major stardom. He didn't seek a lot of film roles. He kind of considered television work a little bit beneath him, but was still quite famous, quite well known, and was considered one of the most talented classical actors of his time. His version of Hamlet, extremely lauded. One of those took acting very seriously, whereas Robert Shaw apparently took acting not as seriously as he took his writing. Nicole Williamson took it deadly seriously and had a little bit of a reputation for being hard to get along with at times because of this. And he reportedly made a comment about Connery saying, "Guys like him talk about acting as if they knew what it was."
Wow. Cold.
Our Will Scarlet is Denholm Elliott, who also won lots of awards, a lot of BAFTAs in particular, most well known for Trading Places and for the Indiana Jones movies where he played Brody. Fascinating guy, Denholm Elliott, shot down over Germany in 1942 when he was an officer for the RAF, spent the rest of the war in a German POW camp where they would create sets out of crates and put on shows for the other prisoners. Gabriel Byrne was once in a movie with Denholm Elliott. Denholm Elliott was the supporting role. Gabriel Byrne was the lead. And Denholm Elliott got a BAFTA and Byrne didn't. So Byrne's comment afterwards, which is reported as being a joke, I hope it was "never act with children, dogs, or Denholm Elliott." The idea, not that Denholm Elliott was being hard to work with, but that Denholm Elliott will steal the spotlight from you because he was such a good
actor. Too good.
Yeah. We have a Sir Ranulph in the movie, played by Kenneth High, also multiple BAFTA award-winning actor. Our Friar Tuck is Ronnie Barker. Again, many awards, extremely popular comedic actor in the UK for many years. It's just really well known, thought of highly of for his dramatic roles, but especially known as being a comedian. And then our two kings, King Richard and King John. Our King Richard is Richard Harris, and our King John is Ian Holm. Again, just actors with huge amounts of credits to their name, impressively thought of. Ian Holm is, of course, Sir Ian Holm, who went on to play Bilbo Baggins. And just this list of actors is almost overwhelming, thinking about the level of just pure talent that is going to be on the screen in this film. Now, you can have good actors, though, in bad movies. And Richard Lester has a bit of a spotted career, so I don't want to elevate hopes too highly. But there's a lot of star power and a lot of talent that certainly went into making this movie.
Even in the cameos as well, because Peter Butterworth shows up at one point, just in one single scene, and that's it. Peter Butterworth, the famous, also comedian, Carry On films, just even the background is studded with these absolute stars.
Mm-hmm. I read that Charlton Heston was offered a cameo in the movie and turned it down because he had wanted to play the lead.
Yeah,
it's only like time that I will thank Charlton Heston.
One other note that I wanted to mention before we get into the film is its original title, or at least the title that it was filmed under, was The Death of Robin Hood. So,
no way.
But
wait, I've seen that movie.
Or we will see that movie, so it's very timely, because just a couple weeks ago, it was announced that a movie called The Death of Robin Hood is being made, starring Hugh Jackman and Jodie Comer. Hmm. And already, like before I even knew that Robin and Marian was originally called The Death of Robin, the description of this Hugh Jackman film that's upcoming sounded like it had the potential to really kind of parallel this movie. We'll see, of course. It's probably going to be a few years still until that one actually gets released. They seem to have been nailing down their cast, but I don't think principal photography or anything like that has started for it yet. So it's been a few years since I've seen the movie. I'm excited to watch it again. Any other thoughts before we dive in?
I'm looking forward to this because this is, when I was growing up, this was very much a definitive Robin Hood for a certain generation of people. And, you know, it was the kind of, it got, I think, a wider American audience than a lot of the other smaller Robin Hood movies that we've seen. And so, yeah, I'm excited to watch it. Momo actually wanted me to tell her when I was going to watch it because she wouldn't come and watch it with me. So
I've heard it referred to multiple times as the post-Vietnam Robin Hood. And so, like we've been discussing, we're getting out of that period that we saw from the 40s and 50s of our swashbuckling Robin Hoods. And here we're getting into we've had a loss of innocence. And I think this is a movie that really will showcase that.
Mm.
All right. Are we ready?
I am. I'm excited.
All right.
Let's do it.
We're going to have a little break in the recording. We're going to play a short snippet of music. But when we come back, we'll have all rewatched Robin and Marian, and our reviews will no longer be spoiler-free. although I feel we gave away potentially a big one with the original title.
I think it was a good move for them to rename the movie and change that, because I think it is kind of nice to leave that a little bit of a mystery.
My understanding is that it was a studio mandate to try to make the movie more marketable and also to help emphasize basically Audrey Hepburn's return to the screen.
As they should.
Yeah, who does not love Audrey Hepburn? Like, honestly, just kind
I've
of
never met someone.
Yeah,
that was somebody.
I know. I don't know. I might doubt it. Universally loved Audrey Hepburn.
I'm certain there's somebody out there with a hate shrine for Audrey Hepburn.
I deny it.
A wall of hate.
Can't accept it in my reality.
That makes sense.
All right. I'm going to go ahead and pause our recording. We are back from watching Robin and Marian. And I always have such a hard time assessing this movie and thinking about where I want to start with it. I think what I want to say from the first off is how accurate I think the assessment is regarding it being very much of its time as a post-Vietnam movie. It feels more than anything like a movie about a person who witnessed atrocities of war, hasn't really been able to process them, and comes home finding that they can't leave the war behind them.
Yeah, there's actually that scene where Robin is remembering a particular action. You know, it opens with kind of an atrocity, then he's remembering another one that involved the death of something like 3,000 women and children. And there's definitely an aspect of that. You know, you could see it haunts him.
Oh, yeah. And that opening scene where we've got the castle burning and you're hearing children screaming.
Yeah. Ooh. It's also very much a product of its time, just in kind of that style of storytelling in movies, that you see this kind of like slow storytelling, things unfolding style of plot in mid-70s movies, early in mid-70s movies, you know, that later on doesn't happen quite at the same sort of pace. I will say, I think this movie suffers a bit from pacing. It's a very slow movie in a lot of ways.
Mm-hmm. Yes, it's like our big swashbuckly action set piece is weirdly lethargic.
Well, and the sheriff's washing up being like, guys, come on.
Well, this is also, though, it's, I think part of that is intentional, because it's meant to be, here's these two old men.
You know, oh, I wasn't old... talking about that part. I was talking about their escape from the castle.
That is exactly what I'm talking about. These are old men who are...
They're younger than you.
I understand that, but they're medieval. So hush your face. You know, they're old men, and they're trying to do the things they did 20 years ago. But they aren't 20 years old anymore.
Yeah, but even when they get up onto the ramparts and they're being attacked. I mean, and I do agree that this is intentional, both in terms of trying to showcase the age of the characters, but also trying to showcase that it is not, you know, we're not going to get the sweeping Korngold score here. We're not. It's just not that kind of movie. It's going for a type of gritty realism. And in fact, my very first note I wrote was literally gritty, because do you recall what was on the screen when they showed the title card and the actors' names?
Yeah, it was like, there was like some apples at first.
It was right after the apples. It was just dirt. It was just brown, sandy, dry dirt where they show Robin and Marian. Literally gritty.
There's a whole lot of brown fabric. Though less than you see in later movies. They at least did have people wearing colors.
That was actually something that I noticed and remembered from the first time I watched it. One of my big thoughts was, and one of my big memories is, that movie was awful brown. Rewatching it, I actually thought, there's a lot more color than I think I remembered before.
Those opening scenes where they were in quote unquote France.
Definitely France.
Were.
I literally wrote down, where the hell in France is this supposed to be?
Yes,
the quarry in France.
The part of France that's found in southern Spain.
Yeah, I was going to say, because that looked very much like a Spanish castle.
Yeah, the filming was all done in Spain. Yeah, but the opening sequence is both very brown and also very weird. And it sets a very weird, almost surrealistic tone for the film. I was thinking about this, and I think it would have been a better movie if it had started like at the 20-minute mark when they first are like re-entering Sherwood. just like everything else before it. I think you could have done without it and it would have been a better movie.
See, yeah, I really love that first scene because I feel like it's signposting the movie for us all, where it says this is not going to be what you think it is. There's that wonderful bit where they talk about trying to get the gold statue out of the castle, but it's just a rock. So it's that thing of if you, the myth is stronger than the reality. So if you go looking for the gold statue, all you're going to find is a rock.
That's a very good point. That is a very good point. That is a nice thematic tie to the film.
Well, it it's almost like, go ahead.
I was just going to say, it's almost like we shouldn't be watching the movie because we get the bit where Richard, when he's dying, says, what are you going to do now, Jolly Robin, now that I'm dead? So sort of saying, like, this is not a story that you're supposed to be seeing. So that sort of melancholic feel to the whole thing, it feels almost intrusive. Like, this is not the story that's supposed to be told, but we're here and we have to deal with it.
Right. And it makes it a movie hard to assess. It makes it hard to provide a lot of critical analysis of. A lot of the our typical splitting arrow questions, like just pretty much all of them, feel inappropriate. We'll still run through them.
I think it may be time to rethink. It may be time to rethink them going into the gritty Robin Hoods.
Yeah, we'll run through them for the funsies, just because it is interesting to kind of see how they sort of still play lip service to some of these elements. And they do still impact how we think of Robin Hood. You know, that bit of gold that we want Robin Hood to be. But how are we even going to rank this Robin Hood compared to other Robin Hoods when it is telling you again and again, I'm not that guy? Whereas every other Robin Hood is, I'm Robin Hood. I'm trying to be Robin Hood. I'm trying to be your hero. This Robin Hood is not trying to be our hero.
Well, I mean, not at first, and then he kind of gets caught up in his own legend, right? Yeah. And that's kind of ultimately what leads to his downfall, you know, is him getting, like, you know, the sheriff and Sir, what, Ranulph? Whatever the heck his name is. Sir Jingly Stovehead. God, that helmet. It looked like a potbelly stove. They come up, they park outside the forest, and all Robin has to do is nothing.
Yeah.
But he's caught up in his own legend, his own idea of who he's supposed to be, that he'd been fighting against kind of at the start, comes back, tries to recapture, relive, get kind of sees the peasants come along into the forest. They're like, oh, you're Robin Hood. I knew it when you escaped. Da, 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 da. And that's kind of what sets him off on that self-destructive path, because he's trying to be that Robin Hood again, and he's not. He hasn't been for 20 years.
If he ever was. One of the things he says right away after they meet up with Will Scarlet and Friar Tuck again, Will Scarlet's singing one of these ballads, and Robin's response is, we didn't do those things.
Yeah, that's true. And that's the thing. Like I said, he's caught up in his own legend, and so he feels he has to live up to it. But he's also, you know, kind of impatient and everything. It's one of those movies of it has a lot of character complexity that is at times better related than others.
Yes, I would agree. What are your thoughts, Emily? Just kind of general response to the movie after not having watched it for a few years, and in particular with our opening question is just, how does it fare compared to expectations, and what are you thinking about the depictions of the characters?
So I think I enjoyed it more than I did the first time I watched it. I mean, coming in, my expectations were based on, you know, memories from a while ago, and I think I enjoyed it more. I like how this is a Robin Hood movie that kind of has an unusual message. Like, it's trying to communicate something through the story of Robin Hood that, I don't think there is another Robin Hood movie that tries to communicate this message. I think this is the only one. So I think that makes it a really interesting entry in the history of Robin Hood on film. And yeah. I think it makes it really special in that way. But I do feel that you have to be in the right mood, maybe, to want to watch this movie, because it's kind of a downer. You know, it's funny at times. It's funnier than I remembered it being. There were a couple of lines that I laughed at that I wrote down for one of the other questions. And it was definitely enjoyable, but it's also really different from mm-hmm. any other Robin Hood movie out there.
Yeah, it's really singular as a Robin Hood film, to be sure. Will?
Yeah, the messaging is the interesting bit, because it's not just a tragic story, because we've had tragic stories. I mean, your most recent one being the Legend of Robin Hood miniseries, where that ends quite tragically and melancholic, where he wins, but he still dies. So there's that sort of happy, sad aspect to it. Whereas this, it's just sad. It's almost like the Great Gatsby thing of you can't repeat the past, and if you try, everything's just gonna fall apart around you. This is F. Scott Fitzgerald's Robin Hood, where if mm-hmm. he tries to reach for the stars, he just falls down. So yeah, it's interesting to, I think it's like, as you were saying, it's very much of its time in that this is not supposed to be a film that gives you a message you can take away beyond the film, where it's just about what's going on in the film. You can't really relate to it. If you can relate to it, then there's a lot more going on in your life than is probably particularly pleasant. But yeah, what they want us to understand, I think, is the troubling thing with it. I think it's quite well conveyed, but it is not very fluffy and light and fun, but I think very important in a way, to have a Robin Hood that actually does this and goes, like we were saying, beyond the story and say what happens next. And it's not necessarily a good thing.
Yeah.
The word that comes to mind for me is quixotic. This is kind of a Don Quixote, Robin Hood. Like I said, he's at the end there, he's practically, he's delusional, right?
Mm-hmm.
And he's, like I said, he's swept up in the legendary of his own character.
Yeah.
You know, he's not quite tilting at windmills, but he's mm-hmm. doing the.
His little speech right before he realizes that he's dying about the like grand adventures that they'll have definitely has that element to it, to be sure. And then, of course, in addition to the character of Robin and his inability to basically be a functioning human being when he also is this legendary character and a person traumatized by 20 years of horrible war, we also have the relationship with Marian, mm-hmm. which is really complex and interesting relationship. At times it is genuinely sweet and moving, other times it's deeply problematic. And it knows that it's problematic. And that's what leads to the murder-suicide at the end, where Marian, and then one of the things the movie often, you know, gets mentioned for is it's the only film version that showcases the traditional ballad to death of Robin Hood, where he is killed by the Abbess of Kirkley's. And then fires his final arrow and says, "Bury me where the arrow falls." And this movie does that. And just that exists is kind of cool. Just like as from like a Robin Hood scholar, like Robin Hood nerd kind of thing, just getting to see that portrayed is interesting. Getting to see it done not by an enemy, but by Marian is also interesting. And that her motivation, from the way I could interpret it, is basically how she knows that their relationship is toxic, but she loves him anyway. And it's her way of protecting both of them because she could only see heartache and pain in the future for them both. So she was clearly seeing it as an act of mercy for both of them. I had a conversation just a couple days ago with some people about this movie, and they were very upset about the ending. And, you know, I'm not going to argue with anybody who's going to say, hey, maybe don't, you know, kill somebody. Like, you know, this is the thing she does without Robin's consent. But Robin had that kind of crazy quixotic thing going on at the time.
It's kind of interesting, too, because I think it almost calls back to her own history of when he left, that she tried to kill herself.
It is
unsuccessfully.
It is well written that way, in terms of it feels consistent with the character that we were portrayed, and how Robin, when he realizes what's going on, accepts it peacefully and kind of happily. And he can see that this is, you know, I'm not advocating suicide. I might need to put a little trigger warning at the beginning of this episode. But based on this is a person who is living in a time when help for people experiencing the kind of trauma he had experienced just didn't exist. You can kind of see why he was accepting of this as the way for them to go. He just had his great victory over the sheriff, and he was going with Marian. They would be buried together. And it's a theme that ran throughout the movie. Like you said, the thing with Marian having attempted to commit suicide before was mentioned before. But we also had Robin and John discussing death in the prison cells earlier on. So I do take back my earlier statement about the movie being better if it cut out the first 20 minutes. Mm. They do lay a lot of important groundwork where Robin and Little John had been discussing in the dungeon cell, you know, having lived good lives, having led fuller lives than most people of their age. So that was also very important foreshadowing to the end of the film.
I'm just going to jump in. There's
a lot of really weird stuff at the beginning. Me too.
I also thought it was really kind of interesting how Marion's attempted suicide was bleeding to death, which is how Robin would traditionally die. Mm. But in this case, he died from poison. And I don't know if that was intentional, but I thought about it anyway.
So, I thought it was interesting because in here, I felt like Marian talking about her failed attempt to kill herself, to die by suicide, I really enjoyed Audrey Hepburn's performance in this, and I thought that writing around Marian was some of the best writing in the whole film.
100%.
Absolutely.
She took what was good material, maybe not the best, superb material, but good material, and she elevated it, which is, of course, what you always want actors to do. And she, for me, stole many, many of her scenes right from Connery's grasp. And the way she talks about it is, it's a transformative moment for her where she makes a decision. You know, she's trying to leave behind this Marian who is consumed by sorrow, who is in love with Robin, who is very, you know, is worldly, and she decides to set that aside and become a less worldly person, a person who feels nothing for men, does not feel the emotions that led her to that point, which for anybody who is familiar with suicidal ideation, that is a very common theme, is you want to put the things that are hurting you, you want them to go away. You want them to stop being the things that are hurting you. I definitely think this episode will require
a
trigger warning.
Yes, there will be a warning at the beginning of this episode. I will also cut in some information about helplines.
Please do. I've lost friends, so. But in any case, no, I thought it was really good. Like, I really love the exploration of Marian as a character, this kind of like 20 years later, Marian looking back and then being pulled back into Robin's whole...
his sphere of influence.
Sphere of influence and everything. And her picking up again where they left off, but recognizing, as you said, the toxicity of it.
Right.
And how it's not just destructive peripherally for Robin, it's self-destructive for him.
Mm-hmm.
And this is a Marian who has some of the, while it is taken away from her at times, she has some of the greatest agency of a Marian that we've seen, right? And in her whole introduction, right, she knows the sheriff is coming to arrest her and toss her out of England. And she's just like, well, I'm going to go, right? And she, and Robin does not convince her not to. He literally kidnaps her, takes her, puts her over a horse. Right, abducts her, which is number one, not cool, but also like it's very telling, right, about that dynamic and everything, mm-hmm. but also the person that she is. I know I've talked a lot, so shut up. But I did enjoy this Marian. I enjoyed Audrey Hepburn's performance immensely.
Yeah, this movie could not have worked with a lesser actress.
I felt Connery was definitely one of the weak points of this movie. And he wasn't terrible, but he was Sean Connery. Never didn't know it was Sean Connery.
And it's only half his fault. The other half is just, it's Sean Connery.
Yeah. And this is really the point in his career where that is like, I think, especially becoming the case. He's already super famous. And he's just at that point of like everything from here on out is, yep, this is Sean Connery being Sean Connery. I mean, I feel like we're kind of agreeing with Nicole Williamson here in his assessment.
Yeah. I will say one thing I do want to touch on, though, is I did enjoy Robert Shaw and his whole frenemy vibe that he had going on, you know, that the sheriff had going on. You know, like, he knows Robin. And that's part of the reason I think that at least some of the tales have some truth, because he knows how to trap Robin. Like, he is not rushing to do things. He knows. He's not setting a really complicated trap because he knows Robin will fall for the dumbest, stupidest trap that I could lay out there. Right? Mm-hmm. And, like, Sir Ranulph is like incredulous, and then it works.
But also, the sheriff knows
that that guy's Robin. Like,
yeah, he knows all of Robin's tricks, so he literally has to do nothing because he knows them all. So as soon as he sees that cart, he's like, ah, he's like almost disappointed. He sees the cart, he's like, oh, Robin.
I did want to
mention though how much he had that element of, oh yes, I know Robin, I know his tricks, I can recognize him. But then also, he's really inept. He doesn't actually succeed in capturing Robin, even though he easily could have. And Ethan is the one that insists that they cut the gate, and then so the portcullis, the rope, so the portcullis drops, and then they can't lift the portcullis to capture him. Robin like really kind of gets away because the sheriff is super inept, even though he is being always kind of presented to us as being confident and capable and in command and in control.
Well, I think it's less that he's inept and more that he's just not in a hurry. Like, he doesn't see a threat in Robin.
Yeah.
Except that a bunch of people got killed. A bunch of his guards got killed. So Robin
doesn't care about them.
But I think it's that thing if he's not afraid of Robin, because we have when Prince or King John now gets told about it and he sends 200 men because he's afraid of Robin, but the sheriff isn't afraid of Robin, not only just in general, but I just don't think that the sheriff thinks that Robin is a threat at all. Like, I don't think he cares. Like that bit at the end where Robin says, if I die, then all these men will just go back to their homes and you won't have a problem. It's Robin individually who's the problem. So that thing again of sparking other people's imaginations, but the sheriff knows that Robin just doesn't want any of this. And so if he doesn't harass him, then nothing will happen. So that's why he's like, well, he'll come to us. So if anything's going to happen, it's because Robin's making it happen artificially rather than there being anything to really fight for anymore.
I'm pretty sure
that the sheriff would have left Robin in the woods if Randolph hadn't gone off and gotten like 200 men.
Mm.
I took it as misplaced arrogance on the sheriff's part. Like, he assumes that he can just capture Robin anytime he wants, but then fails to do so. He just assumes that he'll defeat Robin in single combat and accepts his terms and fails. My read on that sheriff was that he was someone who exuded confidence, but that it was ultimately misplaced.
I could see both readings. I could. Because, like, I could see that. But, yeah, for me, it was just it's the sheriff himself is kind of, like, he seems kind of bored.
Yeah, you know? Like, I spent a lot of time with this particular rewatch watching the way the sheriff interacts with other people. And he's actually quite gentle with other people. Like, there's that servant who offers him food and he says no thank you. So it's this thing of he's a bit he may be a bit arrogant at times, but maybe Robert Shaw is just playing it too kind, because I get the feeling that this, because people say this is a lot about the Alan Wheatley sheriff in the Richard Green series, where he's just a guy doing his job and then he's a little bit villainous just because that's his role that he's playing in the show. But I think with this particular sheriff, he kind of really is genuinely just a guy doing his job. And he doesn't necessarily want to hunt Robin for one reason or another, but it seems like he's actually kind of a nice guy. And it's just that if he's pushed to hunt people who break the king's laws, then he'll go and do it. But he's clearly weighing up the importance there and weighing up the urgency there, because of the bit where Ranulph, or several times where Ranulph is urging him to act. And he's just like, you don't tell me what to do. You ask me if you got to do something. I make the commands here. So he's just breezing through his job, maybe ineptly, but I think also just because he's just genuinely trying to do a good job. Because we see him talk about his admin. We see him talk about the fact that he can read and write. So it's more than just the mustache-twirling Sheriff of Nottingham role for him.
Yeah, we never get any indication really that there's anything particularly villainous or nefarious or abusive that he does.
Yeah, there was actually the whole him talking about, like, there's that little interaction where the sheriff and Robin are talking. He's like, Robin's still not dead, reading the quote because he wanted to remember it. You know, not for want of trying. You look well, all things considered. How was the crusade? A disappointment. After all these years, look at us. I'm nothing but a former captain, and you're still a sheriff. And the sheriff goes, no advancement. You see, I can read and write. Makes you suspect. Not a Duke in 20. Reads a word. Right? And that is, it's a guy doing a job.
And and Sir Randolph even earlier says, books are for clerks.
That is literally right after that. You know, he turns to Sir Randolph. He's like, correct, my lord? And Sir Randolph goes, books are for clerks.
Books are for nerds.
I almost wonder if talking about the sheriff and how he wasn't super villainous, I almost don't feel that this movie really put forward a real villain in the sense of this person is a direct threat to our main characters.
Mm-hmm.
I think that they were, you know, reaching for more of a more of the characters, more of the story, like, internally, rather than, you know, by externally providing a direct antagonist.
Well, that's the kind of thing you start seeing in you know, you see it in a lot of mid-70s movies. It's in late 60s, too, where you don't necessarily have a personified antagonist. It's people against the situation of things. And this is especially true when you see things like this, where it's this kind of sideways commentary on war, on the ravages of war. So for instance, you know, MASH has no antagonist, not really. I mean, you could argue for you know, Frank Burns, but not, he's not really an antagonist. It's a commentary of how people can be self-destructive and, you know, be led to being self-destructive by terrible situations. Like, the best bit of acting for me that Connery did in this movie was actually when he was reminiscing about the horrors of war.
Right. There are bad guys. We have our two kings are both presented as, these guys suck, they're awful. And
this is probably the least likable Richard anywhere.
Very, very bad Richard, very bad John. And that's like why people are kind of willing to flock to Robin and kind of raise a little peasant army, is specifically in opposition to John. And they do make mention of this being during the interdicts, and a couple of mentions here of his conflicts with the Pope. So he's kind of spiritually putting the whole nation at risk. Mm. And
but nobody complains about him like killing them with taxes or anything. It's not that really.
But and he's definitely portrayed as, it's Ian Holmes, it's a pretty small bit he's got as Prince John, but he's portrayed as pretty weaselly, also as a pedophile. And then Ranulph is really the main like threat and physical threat antagonist that we have. All right. We were talking earlier about Marian, though, and how wonderful Audrey Hepburn was in the movie, of course, as much as we had a lot of complexity and dangerous but interesting territory that the character delves into. Emily, you have a special attachment for the character of Maid Marian. And true story, just last week, I was visiting Nottingham and Sherwood with a mutual friend who is going back to the States, and specifically found something Marian related to ship to Emily here, because Marian is her gal.
Yeah, that's
your true. I want your thoughts about this Marian.
So I think this is a really interesting Marian for a lot of reasons. I think probably one of my favorite things about this particular portrayal of her is that she has her own stuff going on. She has an entire life that is separate from Robin, separate from all of those other things. She kind of fell into it post Sherwood Forest and this perceived golden age of them being together. But I really enjoy seeing her in a context where she is very much in charge of her own arc. And she does, like we mentioned, she does get pulled back into Robin's sphere, but seeing her be so capable and taking what she wants as often as she can, even over the course of the film, you know, Robin says, you know, you're not going to Nottingham. She's like, no, I'll just walk there. Don't worry. And she does. She shows up and there she is. And in my opinion, was also important in that she drove the wagon away. Like she cares about what she cares about. And she doesn't let Robin tell her not to care about it. In this case, rescuing her nuns, which I think is just a marvelous little storyline. Oh, we have to go to the castle and rescue Marian's nuns. Okay.
Got it.
I love that. I really, really love that.
For me, I liked that she was powerful without being masculine. They didn't make her shank anybody. They didn't put her into any male roles. They kept her powerful, but in a feminine way. And I really enjoyed that, because that's actually something I dislike, especially you see it in later things where to make a female powerful, they make her violent, right?
Yeah.
And non-feminine.
They give her a sword.
Yeah. They give her a sword, and even in costuming, they'll make her non-feminine. And it's like, women can be very powerful and have tremendous agency while remaining traditionally feminine. And this is not to say anything against warrior women is a thing. I watch Xena. I love Xena. I love power. Yeah, I think powerful women are a great thing and everything. But to use it, but I see it used as a storytelling crutch too much. As a trope too much.
Yeah.
So to see it in this way, I actually did enjoy it, and I found it to be interesting and part of the good parts of the writing on that character.
She is the abbess. She is a woman in power in her time period, in a role that women had during that time period. One of the things that really bugs me about many Marians when they give her power, it's like they're saying like, oh, look, here she is. She has power. She's great. And all of the other women in this time period, I'm sorry for them. Like, that's kind of the message that can sometimes come across. But that's super inaccurate, because women did have power. They did have jobs to do. They did have roles to do. Like, they had their own stuff going on. Marian doesn't have to be able to shoot a bow. She doesn't have to use a sword. Although it is worth mentioning that, you know, one of her oldest stories is her dressing up as a page boy, going out, fighting Robin with a sword and winning. That's great. In fact, there was one line in there where she said, I wish to God I was a man because I'd knock you down. And I thought to myself, but she did. She did. She did just that. So I do really appreciate this, Marian, and how she is in this film.
Yeah.
Yeah, that was actually, like, I remember in many, in past Marians, we have commented that you don't want, you know, we see these passive Marians. Like, that was actually the big disappointment with the Legend of Robin Hood, you know, Marian, that you felt like she should be more active, that she should have more agency, but she just kind of doesn't do as much.
You know? And even though this Marian never swings a sword, never does anything that is violent or physically active more than like driving a cart, she never feels like a damsel.
No.
She literally gets knocked out, tossed over the back of a horse and ridden away with, and yet she still never feels like a damsel.
And I think
she's the voice of reason in this film as well.
She is.
Yeah.
Very she's much. The audience commenting on this thing. Like, what are you doing?
Why are you hitting each other again? She's the person that the traumatized soldier comes home to and is recognizing the trauma that they have.
Speaking a little bit more about being active versus passive, to me an active Marian, it is enough that she is there in the camp, she's doing the work, she's doing the job. Every time we see her, she's doing work. Every single time. She's never sitting around, no matter where she is.
Unless she's cuddling up with Robin.
Yes. Yeah.
Although that implies a certain level of activity too that we just don't see
on screen. It does.
Well, yeah, her confessions are the envy of the convent.
Yes, that's such a good line.
Great.
But you know, that's the thing is like, you know, but even like she takes the active role when she realizes that Robin is going to do something suicidal and goes and pleads with John. Like he'll listen to you. She is active in the role, you know, within the confines of what her role can be, because she has tried to convince Robin not to and failed because he's just too fixated on that windmill, you know, and everything. Yeah. No, for me, she was really the highlight of the main characters. I really enjoyed her. And they could have called this movie Marian and Robin, and I feel it actually probably more appropriate.
Will, you had a comment that you made about how they listed the actors' names on the title screen.
Yeah, so there's this fun thing of who has top billing on this movie. So Sean Connery, obviously, is Sean Connery. Audrey Hepburn is arguably a larger star than him. And she's come out of retirement, semi-retirement, to do this film. Also wants top billing. They couldn't agree on how to appease everyone. So on both the poster for the film and the actual title cards in it, Sean Connery's name is first in a sort of left to right, but Audrey Hepburn's name's higher. She's in between him and Robert Shaw, but her name is higher than theirs. So however you want to read it, it's either Sean Connery or Audrey Hepburn. So there's that interesting thing of how you want to read that. Audrey Hepburn, though, is, I think, clearly the star here.
I'm giving it to Audrey.
Yeah. The movie just lights up when she's on screen.
It really does.
Mm.
So we have two other classic characters in Will Scarlet and Friar Tuck, and they're mostly just kind of there. But we also have Little John, and this movie, more than any other that we've seen, really utilizes the character of Little John and the importance of his relationship to Robin Hood. Will, I was hoping you might want to give your thoughts about this presentation of Little John.
Yeah, I really love it. Not just the relationship that him and Robin have in terms of being buddies and clearly being close and clearly going through things. I find the best Little Johns are the ones that are more emotional than they are violent. So this movie has one of my favorite just little snap descriptions of John, where it's right at the end where Robin says, "No one's gentler in the world, nor half as terrible." And I really love that, because that's really what the best Little Johns are, I think. Ones who are full of just love and support and loyalty to their friends, first and foremost. And then they're big and strong and can beat up anyone second. So that's why I particularly love this version of Little John, because he's far more a friend to Robin and Marian than he is a second, like the lieutenant to Robin Hood, the hero. He's very much the friend. Mm-hmm. So there's this really wonderful layered performance in Nicol Williamson here, being very vicious when he has to be, but for the most part being quite gentle and quite friendly and quite funny. So yeah, I really love this particular version of Little John, and I think it's kind of a template as well, maybe incidentally, for what we see later on, because there's very much shades of this in Clive Mantle with Robin Sherwood, someone who's much more emotional and gentle and friendly than he is violent, but he can turn it on where he needs to. So if Little John is more the gentle giant, I think this is, in terms of film and TV, much more the template than I think people give credit to him for.
Yeah. And there was a lot of intensity, a lot of emotion in terms of his relationship to Robin, and how they had been together for so long that he just kind of couldn't imagine a world without Robin. There was just this platonic couple that had basically lived together for half of their lives.
Well, it's very much a throuple as well, because the film is bookended with those shots of the apples. So we have the three apples, and then the three apples, two of them withered and dying, and one of them on its way out, but alive. So that's very much signaling that this is a movie about Marian, Robin, and John.
Yeah. And, you know, there's that great scene, you know, the night before the battle between Robin and the sheriff, when Marian talks with John and asks for him to protect him. And you kind of get these confessions from both of them that are very emotional, very, very restrained emotion on John's part, where you had seen a few subtle glances and shots, you know, the editing and very subtle acting from Nicol Williamson made it clear that he had at least tender feelings for Marian. And he makes a statement that makes it explicit here. But then you also have Marian's envy that she has of Little John, because he's the one that actually got Robin, where Robin had left her. So you have that, "I would never have left you. He left me for you." The thruple thing is dead on in its way.
Well, and in a certain way, this kind of lends into the whole Robin is this toxic whirlwind, right? Because he sweeps John along with him off onto the Crusades.
Mm-hmm. And that's why, ultimately, how do we rank this Robin? Because he is the protagonist of the film, but he's also the greatest force for chaos and wickedness. He is also the antagonist of the film, both for himself and for all the other characters in a way.
He feels a little, I'm going to say it, he feels a little BPD, a little borderline personality disorder that sweeps people along with him, that he is seeking this excitement and everything, but he also is dealing with the emotional consequences of it. And everything. He swept John along with him. And it's not that they don't have regrets. It's just, you know, yeah, it is a very complex Robin. It's going to be really tough to put on our list.
It's one of the reasons why I do think a charismatic movie star like Sean Connery was still a good choice for that role.
Yeah, well, you need to like him before you start.
Yeah, you need to want to like him. Yeah. And it's part of the reason why I like that story, and I don't know if it's true, about Audrey Hepburn being convinced to do the movie because her sons wanted her to be in a movie with James Bond. Because that kind of speaks to that magnetism already.
Mm. Yeah, you know, that's the thing is that I will say that I agree. You needed somebody with that kind of raw charisma. And if Connery had been just a slightly stronger actor, or maybe just a slightly stronger, able to carry this, because he had the charisma. You could see people following him and falling in love with this role.
Yeah,
as a young, you could see it.
So let's go ahead and run through our list of questions as best we're able to anyway. So where does this adaptation of Robin Hood fall on the scale of gritty outlaw to storybook swashbuckler? And I do think there's one obvious answer, but it gets a little bit more complicated than that. What are your thoughts about that scale here, Emily?
I wrote down my answer for this. I think it falls somewhere in the middle because it alludes to some past potentially swashbuckling stuff that may have happened or may not have happened because he does say, "Oh, we never did any of that." So maybe not, but it kind of alludes to it anyway, or at least it plays on the audience's idea, like this is something that has happened in the past.
Right.
But in the present timeline of the film, I would say it's much more gritty than that. So for me, at least, it's somewhere in the middle.
Yeah. Will?
Yeah, I agree. I think the film actually it's a bit of a cop-out, but it is perfectly in the middle because I think without the past stories, this movie wouldn't work. And the reason it works is because of all that ideological baggage that the audience is coming to this with. So something that I think about a lot with Robin Hood adaptations is if you changed the names of all the characters, is it still a Robin Hood movie or is it not? So, for example, the 2010 film, if you change all the names of the characters, it works just as well as a medieval drama. And that's kind of why it's not necessarily a fantastic Robin Hood movie. But with this movie, if you change all the names of the characters, nothing makes sense at all. Because right. You need this to be Robin Hood. You need this to be Maid Marian. You need this to be the sheriff. So in that sense, it's literally a bit more gritty in terms of the realism of it. But it is using the swashbuckling memory of Robin Hood far more than it's doing realism aesthetically. So I think it's perfectly in the middle.
Yeah. What's your take, Rick?
I agree with Will that you could tell me that this is something a bit like, you know, a follow-up to the Errol Flynn Robin Hood 20 years later with choices made, and it would make sense. You do have to know that it's Robin. You do have to know that it's Marian. You have to know those old stories and everything. But this is the... I hesitate to use the word postmodern, analysis of Robin, but that's kind of what it is. It's this look back on what toll does this kind of thing take? What do you get if you take the Robin Hood and move it forward 20 years?
Yeah.
And look at that through the lens of what we know happens to people at war, you know, mm-hmm. and coming back. You know, because this is also, as we said, you know, this is that post Vietnam Robin Hood, where they've seen a generation come back and not be able to adjust. And Robin comes back, not able to adjust, you know, kind of a thing. But for him, it's not just the war, it's also his glory days. And you have to know those and everything. So I would place it more on the gritty side than the boisterous side. I don't know what the proper right. counterpoint to gritty is, but I think it is the fantastical Robin through the lens of grittiness and retrospection.
Yeah, so I more or less agree in terms of like what we see on the screen, like the like Sean Connery Robin Hood running around not wearing underwear and,
no pants at any point in the whole movie, no
and
pants,
wearing this dingy what is that,
like a gambeson?
Gambeson, that's the word I was wanting. Thank you, Will.
Ironically, yeah, he's wearing a gambeson, which ironically, and I pointed this out to Momo, the Sheriff of Nottingham, when putting on chainmail, does not.
Yeah, he's raw dogging that chainmail.
Right over bare skin, and I'm just like, ooh.
That's not pleasant, especially if you got arm hair. But so he's running around in this like filthy gambeson. He looks like very unwashed. People are sweaty. They're in terms of like, we're going to show like this realistic, like living off in the woods and being dirty, and he's scratching himself and brushing his teeth with a stick. And, you know, like, yeah, it is like almost over the top. On like breaking the gritty scale. And like I said, the opening lines, like the title card, is just over brown sand. But at the same time, not only is there that retrospective aspect that you guys were talking about, there's also how I interpret the end of the movie with that like final arrow shot. And that idea that like the arrow shot sort of represents them living on as the storybook heroes. I think it's important that we never see that arrow fall. We only continue to see it fly outward. And that is indicative, you know, symbolic of that transition from the kind of emotionally damaged, hard-living outlaws to the storybook swashbucklers that we will come to know them as. So, yeah, it's having its cake and eating it too in that regard. But because what we do see on the screen is not a flamboyant Errol Flynnish swashbuckler, the next couple of questions, we'll still go through them, but the expectations are just different. If you're going for a presentation of a swashbuckling Robin Hood, you want to see cool trick archery. You want to see really cool swashbuckling. That would have been out of place in this movie. So with that caveat in mind, though, what was the most impressive feat of archery to your reckoning?
With or without a bow?
Yeah, that's the question.
Yeah, the guy throws an arrow and it lodges itself in Richard's neck. That strong arm.
Canonically, which is how Richard actually died. Not somebody throwing an arrow. He took an arrow to the neck because he wasn't wearing armor, because he didn't feel he needed to. And that's how he actually died in real life. Which we also won't get into the fact that, oh, I met him 20 years ago, yada, yada, yada. And
I was going to bring that up during low points. Yeah.
Which only rolled for 9 years, I think it was.
Yeah, so we get the arrow throw at the beginning of the movie. The regicidal arrow throwing.
Yeah, I have my most impressive one with a bow. Which is actually Little John shooting a guy in the mouth. Who is on horseback. That was for me the most impressive feat of archery. But with an honorable mention for the dude just throwing one like a dart from the top of, top of a rampart, nailing King Richard.
Emily, did you have anything else you wanted to highlight?
Honestly, as soon as I watched that guy throw an arrow hard enough to quote unquote shoot the king, I'm just like, that's it, and I wrote it down. Like that has to be the winner for me. But getting shot in the mouth, that was pretty fun too. A very creative place to shoot someone with an arrow.
Yeah. Will, do you have anything you wanted to add?
Not in terms of good archery. I like the bad archery, though, at the siege at the start where they're shooting the guy with his frying pan and it deflects and it just sort of falls away. Like, yeah. he would be punctured.
Yeah, I wrote...
But they also are throwing arrows up.
I wrote pan blockable arrows.
cast iron, my friend.
Yeah, that's
French skillets.
Problematic. Well, it is not a traditional feat of archery, but what I was just talking about with the end of the movie, where he fires an arrow that is them, the arrow that launches them into legend. You know, I'm going to count that as an impressive feat of archery.
Yeah. No, I agree.
Okay, how about swashbuckling?
I've kind of already mentioned this, but for me, the best part of swashbuckling in this film is just the idea of rescuing Marian's nuns from the castle. Not necessarily how it was actually executed, although it was also probably the most swashbuckling part of the film as well. But like,
yeah,
to me, there's something about the idea of that is just perfectly hilarious and fun. Like, what a good little plot line to follow. I had a lot of fun with it.
Yeah. Will?
Not to deviate too far from the theme of what swashbuckling actually is, but I was thinking the most dangerous thing in this whole movie is when the nuns are running under the portcullis as it's going down.
Yes.
I think that's probably the most dangerous stunt in the whole movie.
these nuns. Nuns. Yeah, for a few moments, they're like, what are you talking about? You're like, he's like, there's a wagon over there.
So good.
Go to the wagon. They're like, what are you talking about? And then they just book it. Boom. Under the portcullis.
They bolt. That was the most impressive physical act in the movie, is clearing that in time.
There was some timing for those stunt people. That was some timing.
Yeah.
Presumably there was a safety rope or something, but that portcullis comes down, right?
The moment I think I want to highlight is, and this is just because last week I was replaying the board game, The Adventures of Robin Hood, that was beautifully created by Michael Menzel. And there was a moment in that game where I had a character trapped in Nottingham Castle and I couldn't figure out how to get him out of the castle. And then another character was investigating a hay wagon and I got like the prompt that the hay wagon could be pushed in front of the castle gate. And then the other character could jump under the hay wagon to escape. And because that is a scene that also does happen in this movie, that is my pick for best swashbuckling moment.
That was also my pick.
And John saying, I could hurt myself.
and then Rob just kind of shoving him.
So good.
Yeah. All right. We did actually have some decent contenders, though, for wittiest bit of banter. Let's just keep going around in this order. Emily, what is your selection for the wittiest bit of banter?
So the first one I wrote down made me like giggle out loud, so I had to write it down, which is, if I had not met you, think what I'd have missed.
Yeah.
So great. And then I also wrote down when Robin says, I won't know what to say regarding going to see Marian again. And then Puck responds, she'll think of something. Yeah. That's great. That's wonderful. I think that's a great setup for her character, too.
Will, do you have a selection for wittiest bit of banter?
Oh, I also like the thing where Robin says that he won't say anything and Tuck's like, well, Marian will say it all for you. You're fine. Yeah. But I also love, we've talked about it a bit already, but the bit where Will says they're talking about the songs of the gang, when Will says they want to hear about the things we did, and Robin says, well, we didn't do them. It's a funny line anyway, but also I think it really just helps tie in those themes of the movie where this is all about the fact of fiction. It's all about living this fantasy.
Yeah.
I think that's a really good highlighting of that.
And it starts with Robin acknowledging that that's a fantasy, that they didn't do them, but then by the end, he's embraced that fantasy.
Mm.
Yeah. Rick, did you have any other selections?
My favorite, wittiest bit of banter was when Robin first sees Marian and he says, what are you doing in that costume? Referring to her wimple. And she says, living in it.
Yes, that was the one.
That's a great line.
Yep. That made me giggle out loud. I thought that was super clever.
It was very clever and also poignant, you know, to the point that was being discussed before about Marian having, that she was literally living it, that she had selected this other life to start leading now and was doing that. Whereas Robin saw it as a costume, saw it as like that, this is not the person you are because this is not the person I left behind. But she's like, this is who it is now. Yeah.
Mm. Was it really fascinating thing throughout the whole movie of costume and performance and things? So like when they get back to the woods and they start properly being a gang again, they all then put on Lincoln Green because they're putting on the costume. They're starting to dress up like Robin Hood. That's what's interesting about Robin getting swept away by his own legend, is that he's lived long enough to start performing the character of Robin Hood himself.
Mm-hmm.
But yeah, that's the very interesting thing with Marian, is that she's pretending to be someone else. And with the gang wearing Lincoln Green again, they're playing at the old days.
Yeah.
It's interesting that Robin and John don't wear green. They're the ones who are sort of not wanting to do this, but are getting swept away as well, but not to the extent where they're dressing up as their former selves.
Yeah, and I wanted to highlight that idea of the kind of multiple balancing identities, because we've seen a few other times where Robin is trying to balance an identity, where he's like, oh, am I Robin Hood the Outlaw, or am I Sir Robin of Locksley, or the Earl of Huntington, or the Henry Earl of Nottingham, or whatever they're doing for that particular movie. And that little bit of like, which one am I? A couple of times recently, we've seen I want Marian to fall in love with Robin the Outlaw, not with the nobleman who I secretly am. So you sometimes get like some sort of play with a double identity. Here, it is done in a really beautiful way with Marian trying to assess her identity. Am I this prioress, this life that I've been living for 20 years, or am I Marian, this outlaw woman living in the woods that's exciting? And seeing the attraction of both of these lives and trying to come to terms with that. That was something totally different from anything I've seen before, and compellingly done.
Yeah, that's what's interesting about her as Janet, is that she's content, but she's not happy. And when she's miserable because she's now worrying about Robin's life again, she's happy. So it's that complicated thing of she's only happy when she's miserable because she's not wanting to see Robin die. She's only happy when she's in this terrible place, which goes back to what we were saying earlier, that this is a toxic relationship, not necessarily because they don't love each other. And it's kind of not really codependent, because I think they've both sort of demonstrated that they are happily living apart, but it's kind of the idea of each other, which is the strongest thing. And so it's toxic in that way. They can literally live apart, but the idea is the thing that is pulling them together more than the reality.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, it's that attraction to danger component as well.
He flirts with death.
Yes. But they all look like you.
yeah, that'll get her happy again. you're not going to be thinking about that the rest of the day.
There were some weird lines in this movie like that. There's also like when she finally like succumbs to his charm, she's, it's her actual line, hurt me, make me cry.
And I get it. Yeah, that's that, like, I've been kind of numb, just kind of living this peaceful life. I want something just exciting again. I want something that is more emotional. And that, and that's the nature of their toxic relationship. And she's not saying, obviously, to physically hurt her in that situation. But
oh, my God.
That emotional wrong. That was for the audience. The audience. So she is not asking to be physically hurt by him.
It was just, it was a very weird, kind of an odd line.
Yeah.
I got it. But she hadn't, you know, it was just kind of strange.
All right. So next up is, who wins the Merriest Man Award? The character, aside from Robin, you would select as a member of your outlaw gang, and why? Although in this case, I don't know that Robin is the one who you would want. But if you're forming an outlaw band, which character from this movie would you select to come with you into the forest? Emily?
I went with John. I mean, and maybe it's biased because he had a lot of screen time.
Mm-hmm.
But he was practical. He was reliable. He was a good friend. To me, that choice makes the most sense. So I'm going with John.
All right. Will?
I think probably also John, but it's slim pickings.
Mm-hmm.
Because mm-hmm. everyone has a very bad fate, even if you're trying to be subversive and pick a baddie to be in your very bad. It's not pleasant. It's not fun. You're not going to get what you want out of it. You're not going to get your money worth. So probably John, but I'd take him somewhere where he can be happy.
Yeah. And he'd be good company.
He would be good company.
Yeah, Rick?
Like Will, it's slim pickings. And Little John is the obvious answer. But for her ability to be the voice, try to be the voice of reason, I personally would rather have Marian to ride herd and keep sanity going. Like we said earlier, she does a lot.
She'll challenge you. When John will not. John is exceedingly loyal.
And when she's not poisoning you, she can also heal you.
Right.
Yeah. But that's like, I think that's actually my choice is Marian. Because if he listened to Marian, he would have had a happy life in the woods, probably.
I can see reasonable answers for either of them. Just to be a little bit thinking outside the box, my pick is going to be the old one-eyed man who killed King Richard. Because even though he's only got one eye, he sees more clearly than everybody else. He realizes that the treasure is just a stone. He can block arrows at the frying pan and can throw an arrow over 100 yards to kill a king.
One big pick.
I'm feeling pretty confident with him on my team. he doesn't have a name in the movie. He's just called Old Defender. Okay. The next one is again one where it's like we're assessing this a little differently, but the question is, how robbed were the rich? On a scale of 1 to 10, how do you think Robin Hood fares as a champion of the oppressed? With a 1 being a Robin that was either unconcerned or ineffectual, and a 10 being Bernie Sanders with a bow, champion of the people, bringing the aristocrats to their knees and all that.
Well,
didn't really rob anybody except a merchant. And he did pay that guy.
He paid him, yeah.
Left him without his clothes and everything, and he stole that table, but then again, it's like forcing money on people. It felt, I don't think the rich were robbed at all, but it did feel like he was kind of going through the whole like, well, this is what I'm supposed to do because I'm the good guy.
I'll give him 2 for having stolen some nuns from Nottingham.
Yeah, I guess that's, yeah,
but
sure.
Again, it's like, how do you qualify it? Because that's not the point of this movie. It's not trying to give us a Robin Hood who actually is doing these things.
I wrote down a quote, actually, to go into this question, which is that when they were talking about the old life in Sherwood, Robin said, "Didn't seem like much compared to rescuing the Holy Land." Like, so assuming, perhaps, and it's definitely an assumption, assuming that maybe they did do some robbing of the rich to benefit, or it didn't matter. You know, assuming, of course, that they did any of it.
Right.
It didn't matter. So I'd probably give it a one, to be honest.
I didn't see
any of it. So.
Yeah. Will?
Yeah. Probably a minus. A minus one. Because, yeah, I'm assuming that none of the classic story happened and it was just a bunch of guys skirmishing, the sheriff being the thorn in his side, just pissing them off for a couple of years and then nipping off to the Holy Land. Being a thorn in his side enough to get the king's attention, but then being roped in. And then it's the idea of Robin, which is not Robin's fault, but it's the idea of Robin that then gets everyday people rushing to join him, and then they end up being cut down in their dozens at the end of the film. So,
yeah, their situation is made worse because of Robin Hood.
Yeah. And again, it's not necessarily Robin's fault, but he should have probably turned them. Like, it's not his fault for them turning up, but he should have, in all good conscience, turned them away. But instead, he's like, you know what? I am a hero. I can do this.
Mm-hmm. Right. Okay. So, low points. And I certainly have a few that I want to go over. Emily?
The low point that stands out the most to me is that, why weren't they wearing pants? I find that so distracting. Like, you know, Robin's like coming out of a tree or something. I'm just like, how much of Sean Connery's butt did I need to see? I didn't need to see any of it.
Your low parts were Sean Connery's low parts.
Correct. Absolutely. I just feel like the costuming department could have given them a little something to wear. Something. I don't know.
Not on Sean Connery's watch.
The costuming in general is one of the major low points I wanted to mention. A lot of the time it's totally fine, but other times it is distractingly bad. Most of the things that Sir Ranulph was wearing in particular, even when he didn't have the weird pot kettle helmet on.
Weird scale mail thing?
Yeah.
With ear holes. Did anyone see the ear holes and like that?
Yes.
I don't think that's what that looked like.
Yeah, there were just a number of times where the costuming was distracting. Where you would have some kind of scene coming out and a lot of the drama was getting lost because somebody was standing there looking just ridiculous.
I did love the nuns' habits. I thought those looked very practical and realistic to me. I don't know about the actual veil and wimple part, but like their actual habit that they were wearing, that felt very right to me.
Yeah.
So I was excited.
Yeah. They went nice and simple. They didn't try to go ostentatious with the nuns. Those worked.
Yeah, it definitely worked for me, the nuns' habits.
Most of what the guards were wearing and most of the sheriff's outfits, not all of them, but most of them felt fine. Mm-hmm. Like, you know, they weren't.
Liked Robert Shaw's outfits. He had good outfits.
That red thing he was wearing in the middle? Holy cow.
That was a good one.
He might have my favorite Sheriff of Nottingham costumes of all time.
It's fair.
Mm.
But a lot of the rest of it didn't work, especially Sir Ranulph. His
yeah, work. Like I think he only ever, we only ever saw him in armor. I don't think we ever saw him out of it. Like, we saw him with his coif down a few parts, but never actually outside of that, whatever the hell it was. I'm going to call it scale mail, even though it wasn't really a thing. But and if you looked at it, like, those little scales, they were traditional shield shapes, and they were each ridged around, like, they were individually crafted. So the amount that money that must have cost, even as a costume, it must have cost quite a bit.
Yeah. Will, did you have any low points that stuck out to you?
Oh, apart from that, it is so clearly not France at the start, and so clearly not England at times. That's a just practical filmmaking thing. So I don't begrudge the film too much. Yeah, apart from the things that we've already mentioned, I think there's something about this film that I can never quite put my finger on that doesn't sit right, and I'm not quite sure what it is. I think it might be that it's too subtle with its themes, because they're there from the very first shot of the apples, and they're there from all this conversation about this costume you're wearing, and we never did this, so it's meaning there, and it's subtle
and preparedness for death, and
yeah. I just think it could be a little bit stronger bringing those themes out, because I think for the first half it's phenomenal, and then the second half you kind of get lost in, oh, when's the big fight going to be, and so some of those thematic things get lost. And so that would be my low point overall, is that it's almost a Robin Hood movie that makes you feel something and think something, but by the time the credits roll, you forget to maintain that that momentum and that reading of the movie, and so in the end you're just sad and depressed when it should be this fascinating character study that it is for 45 minutes out of the 90.
Yeah. Rick,
well, so I think this movie has a couple of issues, some of which we've touched on, but I think some of it is that the Robin Hood, while he's charismatic, he's not actually a particularly likable person. Like, he has admirable qualities, but he's not actually a likable person.
Mm-hmm.
It's not a lack of charisma. It's just, you can sense the toxicity in this Robin. And you can see how people would get swept up in it without yourself being swept up in it. And it's a weird feeling, because when you're go to a Robin Hood movie, you're used to being swept up in that energy. I feel that the directing was a little clumsy in places. And like Will said, there was definitely just a case where sometimes stuff was just a smidge too subtle, right? And there's nothing wrong with subtle filmmaking. I love, you know, good storytelling. But there's subtle filmmaking, and then there's filmmaking where the message isn't conveyed.
Right.
And there are places where you can definitely tell where they were trying to convey things and it didn't come through. And one of the places I'll point to is actually like the kind of like the discussion we had over Robert Shaw's sheriff and kind of the nature of that character and his relationship with Robin Hood. One of the main ways that it would have been nice to see Robin Hood, and you could see the attempt in it, is in the reflection in the Merry Men. And you see it somewhat in Little John, but you see it, you don't get as much from Will Scarlet, who they could have named him Alan Adale, plays a freaking, you know, lute, you know, he plays I don't know what that is. I guess it's some kind of lute or a harp.
Oh, it might have been a guitar. No.
No, I don't think it was. I don't think it's a guitar. It's something. I don't know what it is. But like, they could have named him Alan Adale. It would have made more sense, given that he sings the songs and tells ballads. But like, there's no reflection, partially because the other Merry Men are not developed out. Like,
yeah.
Tuck doesn't feel like Tuck, right? Will Scarlet feels more like Alan Adale, but also very generic.
They both got quite the short shrift in terms of development and screen time.
Yeah, so we get this, they're reminiscing about the old days on a certain level, but it's not quite as effective as it could be. And I think of back to, oh, the other one where we kind of wanted to just see the Merry Men and Robin Hood get together. Was that, which one was that one? It wasn't Men of Sherwood Forest. It was
the one where the our other old Robin Hood.
Yeah,
that's Bandit of Sherwood Forest. Bandit of Sherwood Forest. Robin, yeah.
It was otherwise terrible. Like, I would have rather watched that. Like, but, you know, there where they're reminiscing, you got that chemistry of these are people who are old friends and they knew each other.
Yeah, and they did that really well in Rogues of Sherwood Forest.
Yeah, Rogues is a really good version.
Rogues of Sherwood Forest. And in here, it wasn't there. Like, that chemistry just wasn't there, right? And it would have been nice to have that, because and this is where I get back into this is the Robin with borderline personality disorder and kind of a quixotic complex, is you aren't seeing them get swept up again in his energy as
much. Right. You get this with Marian, but you don't with them.
You get it with Marian, and you get John, who's never stopped being swept up in it, even though, you know, he has this kind of self-reflection. But it would have been, but like, if we'd seen that in those parts, then I think it would have sold it better. Mm-hmm. Right? Mm-hmm. Because you would have seen the hearkening back to these stories and some of the things that may or may not have happened before. And he's pulling people along with him. But like, you know, there's a scene when the peasantry first shows up in the forest, and they are obviously getting swept up in it, and Robin just kind of motions to Friar Tuck to give them food, and Tuck kind of gives them this look of, you could almost hear the words, what?
Yeah, what? I was kind of wondering, like, oh, they've got enough food to feed all these people that just showed up,
right? And I think that they didn't, but Robin is getting swept up in his own legend. That's the start of it. Mm-hmm. And of course, just feed the people, right?
Yeah. Get it done. Yeah.
Yeah, just get it done. Right. And there's that little bit of self-doubt. And if that, and they could have gone either way. They could have played it where Tuck and Scarlet are getting swept up, or they could have played it where they're kind of like doubting it. And they didn't actually end up doing either. And so it just kind of falls flat.
We didn't get Tuck's response in any way.
Yeah. We got a momentary look of confusion and then resignation. And it's that whole thing of, it's just too subtle, right? To effectively sell either one. Will it look like?
Oh yeah, I was just thinking, I remember a bit at the end where Tuck and Will are caught and hanged, but it wasn't in the version that I just watched, and I'm half wondering if I just made that up or not. But that's kind of the thing that their story comes to anyway, is that they're sort of introduced, they're around, and then they die. Like you were saying, they don't even get incorporated into the plot of being like questioning being brought back into Robin's world again. They're just sort of props for it, to the point where, like you said, Tuck is almost like, what do you want me to do? You want me to start being Friar Tuck again?
Yeah,
and it was kind of one of these things of, yeah, they do. You see them get captured at the end, and it was interesting because it was I think it was a little bit of them starting to get swept up in things, and then it fails. Not even a rebellion falls apart very quickly, because it's peasants being run out of an open field into a forest, but they aren't deep enough into the forest to set up any ambushes or anything against professionals.
Yeah.
So yeah, it's a movie where I think if it had had, I don't want to say a better director, but maybe just a slightly different directorial direction, that's not a phrase. A slightly different directorial feel, somebody who could handle that subtlety a little better, it would have been probably considered, you know, an even better movie and been less ambiguous about how people would react to it and how I would feel about it.
Mm-hmm.
I do. That being said, I did enjoy the movie. I think it's worth watching. you know, as part of the Robin Hood corpus, but go into it kind of, don't go into it expecting a Robin Hood story as you're used to.
Definitely not. Emily, did you have any other low points or things that you wanted to bring up?
The only other thing I would maybe mention is that when Robin essentially kidnaps Marian, he does hit her to knock her out. And I wasn't a super fan of that. but I don't know. They played it off in the film in a way that it didn't make it seem like a big deal. And yet to me, it's still kind of a big deal.
Yeah, it's
so,
not good. No.
That's no, not ideal. But honestly, you know, otherwise, the film definitely has a general low feeling overall that within the landscape of itself as a film, the lack of pants and Robin knocking Marian out, that's what I wrote down. So.
Yeah, so the things that I also wanted to highlight were just similar to the costuming we mentioned, just how there's a handful of things that are just kind of weird or distracting, like the whole timeline with Richard, like, well, I've been serving Richard 20 years since he went off on the crusade, but Richard had only been king for 10 years in the actual history. And so it's like, what is this timeline? How does this work? When did Robin meet Richard? How was he away for 20 whole years? 20 years is such a long period of time. How did that even go that they were away that long? And then, like, Richard dies and it's suddenly, you know, in the actual history timeline, 10 years into John's reign. And it's like, what? Like, that was all just really confusing and distracting. So, and there's no reason why it had to be 20 years. It could have been 10 years. There was ways that they could have just tightened that up a little bit and it would have been less anachronistic and less confusing. There's just weird little moments, like when you go to King John's camp and you get a bunch of guards and they're doing an choral number, they're just like singing. And it's just
that weird. Was weird
when yeah. You get the whole siege at the beginning where they dig a rock up out of the ground, fire it at a catapult
with their hands.
And it lands like 20 yards too short of this castle, but then you find out they don't even know if there's anybody in this castle, and then they fire the arrows that the guy blocks with the frying pan. It's just like, it almost felt like a comedy skit. It was so weird. And then the like funeral procession for King Richard was so weirdly small and chintzy, and the king's just in this little wooden box and there's six people around him, and it's like, I'm pretty sure Richard the Lionheart would have a bigger retinue than this, even if this is like a pre-funeral. It's not the big state funeral or whatever. Like, well, I've seen like a high school play could put on something more convincing in terms of this looks regal. Like, it just looked so cheaply weird. So there is just a lot of moments like that would take me out of the movie. They were distracting, they were weird, and just like unnecessarily weird. But then the only other thing I wanted to highlight, and we've kind of touched on it before, is Sean Connery's acting and how much he was outperformed by Marion, and you could really by Audrey Hepburn, and you could see Audrey Hepburn being this Marion who was kind of falling back in the habit of being in love with this Robin, but you didn't get the same level of passion being returned from Sean Connery, and I think that's what would have sold that relationship better, and I think that's one of the things that ultimately makes the movie not work as well as I want it to, is that the passion doesn't feel as real as I want it to between the two of them.
It comes in flashes, Sean Connery's performance, because it's hard to tell whether the script is supposed to be that Robin is keeping Marian at arm's length and saying, oh, I haven't thought about her in years, when really he's been thinking about her every day, or if it's just Sean Connery's lazy acting, making it seem like he genuinely hasn't thought about her in 20 years. But I remember the first time I watched this movie, the bit where Robin sees Marian in the window in his abbess, and his face just drops and he goes, dear God, it's Marian. Like, I think I teared up at that because it was such a raw reaction.
Yeah.
Of Robin seeing Marian for the first time in 20 years, and he's just so shocked by seeing her, as if he didn't really expect to see her there, sort of thing. That's kind of, I think, Sean Connery's approach to this, is that he puts it all in, but only in these tiny little moments, only where it really matters dramatically, because the rest of the movie is like, oh, this is just a scene with dialogue in it. But when there are big emotional scenes, he actually goes all in. And it's that question of, is he required to be a little bit better than he is, or is he just giving what the script demands, which is just talk about the good old days?
Guys like him talk about acting as if they know what it is.
So good.
Okay, so how do we rank this Robin? On our list of Robins from best to worst, we currently have 15 Robins. And I don't know how to put him on this list. Because by some metrics, he's just the worst. He is the worst Robin. But by other metrics, in terms of this is an interesting movie that's doing interesting things about trying to tell how we interpret and interact with this legend, then it becomes a compelling and interesting take on Robin Hood. I mean, I think I'm willing to ding him a couple points for the lack of pants.
He's Scottish.
Okay, so like you said, it's a tough one to rank. Honestly, I'm going to put him down at the bottom. And some of it is the way it was written and the plot, you know, in the plot of this story and what it is. But also some of it is just Connery being Connery, and like you guys said, his performance comes in these bursts, right? There's moments of really good acting and really very good performance. And there's others where he just, you could see he's trying, but he's not pulling it off. But Connery is just not a good enough actor. Or maybe the direction wasn't good enough from the director.
Right.
Or maybe whatever. It just didn't work. And those are, you know, and everything. So I'm not inclined to rank him very high. I'm inclined to rank him.
Also, he punches Audrey Hepburn.
Punches Audrey Hepburn, and that's an automatic no, because Audrey Hepburn, fantastic person.
Okay, so
I'm debating above or below Lex Barker. Like, that's where I'm at.
I'm comfortable with saying that this is our worst Robin, in that, as we mentioned, there is nothing he does that improves anybody's lives. Everybody is worse off than they were before. Yeah. Like, and then, everybody.
Yeah, and I think that's where I place him, is right down at the bottom. And again, you know, I don't, for people who really enjoy this movie, maybe this is one of their favorite movies ever. You know, I don't want to, you know, I've said my criticisms, but as a Robin Hood, he is not a good one.
And also this list is as Robin Hood. It is not a rating of the film. Because while he is a bad Robin Hood, the movie is trying to make him be a bad Robin Hood. So the movie is succeeding. And also, to be clear, though, while he is a bad Robin Hood, he's not unlikable. You know, we've said multiple times, this happens, it's not his fault, this happens. It's, yeah, you want to like this Robin, you want to root for him, you want him and Marian to be together, because she wants it, And that's why. Mm-hmm. Emily, you had something that you had mentioned before. So you recently acquired a book that's a screenplay, right? And
yeah.
It has some additional notes. And you said you found something interesting in there?
I did. So I bought this book for my collection because it has Marian's name in it, so I have to say if they have it. But anyway, I thought it was a novelization of the film. It's not. It is the screenplay with 54 pages of introduction by James Goldman.
Hmm.
And he was talking about how when he was learning more about Robin Hood and reading through different ballads and trying to kind of get a grasp on things, how he felt really disappointed with the traditional death of Robin Hood and how he felt it didn't have enough meaning. And then he says this, and I'm just going to read this really quickly. "Then one day I came across a ballad which I have since been unable to locate. But I remember it. It was short and fragmentary, and unlike all the others. What it said was this, and to paraphrase, he claims, and I feel like he might be hallucinating, but I'm willing to be proven wrong, that he found a ballad where when Little John takes Robin to the Abbey, the door opens and it is Marian." And I'm just like, I am so sure that's not true, but if there was a group that might know, I thought Will or Thad may have heard of something like this, but I have never. And I have been on my Marian is my favorite ride since ages. So has anyone ever heard of this? Or is this man hallucinating something?
I think he's making that up. There's right? When you said he came across it and then he can't find it again, made me laugh, yeah. Because that is exactly what Richard Grafton in 1569 said when he wrote about Robin Hood as an earl. He said, "In an old and ancient pamphlet, I find this said of Robin Hood, that he was descended of a noble parentage or else was made an earl." So it's that thing of, it's a very old style that you claim that you've seen something in an old ancient thing that you can't find anymore because it was a book that someone gave to you. It's even in the History of the Kings of Britain, that great old sort of 10th, 11th century, I think, chronicle of England that includes the majority of the King Arthur story, where he says, "Oh, I saw this in an old pamphlet. I can't remember who gave me this book, but I just borrowed it from him and it had all this in it, but I can't remember what it is or where it is. Sorry." It just smacks of that, where it's like he's claiming authority mm-hmm. through having read something, but I can't quite remember what it is. But yeah, there's absolutely no... unless he did genuinely find it and has lost it, that is not true.
Yeah.
Yeah. He can't cite a source.
Yeah.
No. That ballad totally exists. They just live in Canada and you wouldn't have met them. They go to a different school.
Right. No, it sounds like the sort of thing where he had read The Jest of Robin Hood or something else that encapsulated it in that story of the abbess. The prioress of Kirklees, and at some point just in his brain trying to make a connection to make it be a better story, inserted the most prominent female character associated with Robin into the role.
Yeah.
I agree with his notion that the main problem with that story, and probably why we don't see it get adapted more often, is because there isn't a lot of weight to it. Traditionally given, who is this prioress? Why does she kill Robin? You know, you have to do a lot of lifting if you're going to tell that story and make it work.
Yeah, it's interesting because the story of Robin Hood's death, that is the 17th century version of the death of Robin Hood, is a adaptation of the last few lines of the medieval poem, The Jest of Robin Hood, except that whoever compiled that for the first time to make it one long story from five or six different stories didn't have the full death of Robin Hood story, which is why it's only seven or eight lines. So the story is already, from the first time it appears, really fragmentary and we don't know a lot about it. And then the later ballad is an adaptation of that. So if it is possible to know what that early meaning is, it's already completely muddled. So it's not lost, but it is... you have to dig through a lot of later source material in order to try and find out exactly why this Death of Robin Hood story existed at all in the Middle Ages.
Mm-hmm.
Probably to do with, I imagine, ideas of trust, because the point of the medieval stories is about testing your moral compass and things. And so it's probably a thing of Robin went to this person because he trusted them. But if you read the jest, it's just, and she bled him and he died.
Yeah, it always read to me a lot as, I gotta wrap this up now.
Yeah, so it's important enough a story for the compiler to have included it despite not having a full copy to hand. So we know it's important, but we don't know why it was important necessarily, which is interesting.
And frustrating.
And frustrating. And very, very frustrating.
All right. So would I be correct in assuming that all of us are more or less on the same page in terms of, yes, we would recommend this movie because it's going to be a different experience than anything else that you're going to find. And because it is, does have moments that are beautiful, does have moments that are impactful, but just be aware that it is also has some notable flaws and perhaps a questionable editing and directorial choices.
I think this movie almost works best if you are already aware or a fan of Robin Hood, because it does so much play on the audience's prior knowledge.
Could you imagine being somebody's first Robin Hood movie?
Yeah, I don't think I could recommend this to someone who wasn't a fan. Like, I don't think I would go up to a random friend and say, hey, I just watched this over the weekend, you should check it out, because I don't think my friend would be very happy with me about that recommendation. I think they'd be confused. So I do think this is a worthwhile film if you are invested in the story of Robin Hood on a somewhat deeper level. But without that knowledge, I think likely just doesn't hit the right way for it to be as enjoyable.
Yeah, I agree. I think it's the important thing with this film is the title and what that sets up for expectations. So I think the title is a really important thing when it comes to particularly Robin Hood, where everyone has some sort of idea of who the character is. And so, like we talked about right at the very start, that this was originally called The Death of Robin Hood. And I think if it was called The Death of Robin Hood, then you'd be going into it, but it would be remembered far better because the expectations would match what it's being sold as. When you're buying a ticket to a movie called The Death of Robin Hood, and this is what you get. But they changed the title because they didn't think anyone would want to see a depressing movie. But that probably did worse because they changed it to Robin and Marian. The slogan on all the posters is love is the greatest adventure. And so if you're talking about mis-selling the movie, then what they changed it to is far worse. So yeah, that's something I think about a lot with Robin Hood, is like when people don't like a Robin Hood movie, particularly the more recent ones, is it a bad movie, or have they been sold the wrong movie? So the 2010 film, if it was called Nottingham or something else, if it was called Legend or something, would they get more out of it than it being called Robin Hood? They go expecting to see Robin Hood. With this, it's called Robin and Marian. They're told love is the greatest adventure. But if it was titled The Death of Robin Hood, would people be much more on board with it, and it would have been remembered fondly because they'd get what they paid for?
This movie is the third in a trilogy where the other two were not made.
This is
the follow-up movie you get 10 years, 20 years after the first two movies were successful, and they're bringing the actors back. Except those other two movies were never made.
Thanks for bringing up that tagline there, Will, because I did want to highlight that. It brings to mind the line that gets repeated multiple times in the movie Hook about how death is the greatest adventure. Because I feel like that would in fact be the better tagline for this movie. Or at least the more accurate to its messaging.
For sure. And Hook's probably another good example where people have been missold something, but it's hard to know what you could have called Hook to get people to accept what it was. Because I really love Hook, but I know people really hate it. But I think that's such a huge gulf, because what it is just you haven't gotten a Peter Pan movie, but you were never going to. So that's where titles are actually incredibly important, because that's what sets your audience expectations, because you're buying a ticket or you're popping it up on Netflix based on what the title is. And if you're, so it'll be interesting to see in a couple of years when the Hugh Jackman movie comes out, which, if it keeps the title, The Death of Robin Hood, if anyone's going to come in, Robin Hood died in that movie. But, yep. In the title.
Yeah. And, you know, and it's interesting because clearly with, as we said right at the beginning, this is this much more cynical, this post-war, we are trying to tell a meaningful story about damaged people, and it is not a happy story. Robin, like, kills a lot of people and then lies about it. You know, like, really, there's drastic things that happen in this movie and are very cynical, especially because he's taking King Richard to task for the atrocities Richard committed while lying about his own acts of violence. So it's definitely this cynical, darker type of filmmaking that was starting to arise at this point, but marketing departments and studios weren't there yet.
No.
All right. Thank you so much for hopping on, watching this movie. It is, like I said earlier, one that I feel so conflicted about. It's such an interesting movie. I'm so glad that it exists, because it is so interesting. It is far and away not my favorite Robin Hood movie. It's not the one that I would say, like, if you want to have a good time watching a Robin Hood flick, I'm not going to recommend this one. But it is still such an interesting, such a different film that gives you so much more to think about than most of the films. So this has been Into the Greenwood, Splitting Arrows. If you have watched this movie, if you have thoughts about what its title should be or its tagline, I would love to hear what you think about Robin and Marian, what you think about Sean Connery's performance or any of the rest of it. Feel free to get in touch. We're on just about all the social media channels with the handle at Into Greenwood. That's Facebook, Instagram, Threads, Blue Sky, the website formerly known as Twitter. You can also email us directly with that email address, intogreenwood@gmail.com. If you want to support the show, because it does take a while to do all the editing for these things, as well as cost money to host these on the websites, that is patreon.com/intogreenwood or buymeacoffee.com/intogreenwood. Any little bit would help. Also, any word of mouth, reviews, ratings, anything like that would really help a whole lot too, to just help get the podcast found by others. If you're a big fan of this movie, maybe share this episode with other people. Get their thoughts on it too. That would all be appreciated.
If you're a huge fan of this movie, talk about how much you hated this episode of the podcast and think we're hacks. There's no such thing as bad publicity.
Tell your therapist about it.
Yeah. And if you need help, please seek help. Don't take the Maid Marian route. Not in this film's case. Yeah. Love you all, and thank you for joining us in the Greenwood.
Thank you very much.
All right. Good night, everybody.
Thank you. By the good Robin Hood, Robin Hood, Robin Hood.
And that was probably their biggest hit. They had a few other ones, though. None of them jumped to mind. But that's okay. This isn't the I Love the 80s podcast.